Ms. Austin?
Here.
Mr. Houchens?
Here.
Mr. Murphy?
Here.
Note, Ms. Shelton is absent. Note, Mr. Newman is, Dr. Newman is absent. Mr. Fraley?
Here, Chair acknowledges that we do have a podium, a quorum. And with that, we get right into our presentations. Thank you, Susan. Okay.
The first item on your agenda is a request by the City Planning Commission for a text amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance to revise and remove inconsistent definitions and fix clerical errors in Section 3.9.6b, definitions, Section 3.9.7g, definitions, Section 5.7.3, definitions of terms, and Section 8.3.2, terms defined.
Jeremy, you look almost embarrassed to have to come before us.
Should I rest my case? So we have four different definition sections in the ordinance. There is a good reason why we have four different definition sections, but we do have four different definition sections. So they were crafted at slightly different times by slightly different people for slightly different reasons. And as such, they have some inconsistencies. So we've learned over the last year and a half since we adopted that we have some things we need to fix. So the bulk of what we're doing here is just making corrections, duplicating definitions or referencing, doing cross references, things like that. Those are all very simple. There's nothing substantive at all to those. There are four additional ones I want to point out that are slightly substantive that I want to make sure are noted for the record, that are not a matter of inconsistencies. They are just things that we know we need to fix in the definition sections. There are four things. One has to do with how fences are defined in the Chesapeake Bay Preservation Area. So we're essentially saying that a fence is not an accessory structure for that purpose. That is a matter of the way we've been doing it for decades, and it just wasn't clear in the new ordinance. So that needs to be cleared up, so we're correcting that. Two, we have to, believe it or not, clarify the definition of a porch in the ordinance. Because we deal with a lot of porches on a lot of new houses, and there are some uncertainties as to what exactly is a porch and what exactly that means. So we're doing a little more clear of a definition. We're defining disc jockey a little more clearly as well. That's not a defined term right now, but you all know it does become a topic of conversation fairly often. So from an enforcement standpoint, it's good to have that. And then also finally defining dwelling unit to really clarify what is and what isn't a dwelling unit. So if you're adding a man cave to your garage, that you know, we know when it's crossed the line from a man cave that may not, or a she shed as the commercial has. So you know whether or not that's actually a dwelling unit when they add the shower or the kitchen or things like that. So those are four things that are actually substantive that we are actually changing with this amendment. Just wanted to point those out. We don't feel that any of them are going to be problematic. They're really still clarifications, but they are actual substantive changes.
Jeremy, you brought up a topic there that, as an appraiser, I know has always been a subject of contention, the difference between a porch and a stoop.
So currently, stoop is defined, porch is not. So one of the things we want to do is actually remove the definition of stoop, because a stoop typically wouldn't have that covering on it. We define that differently in the ordinance. What we really need to do is define what a porch is. We've seen a lot of builders come up with sunken porches, essentially, where you would have either end of the house project out and the porch sinks in, or the front porch ends up being around the corner and down the side. We wanted to be clear that that wasn't the intent of the ordinance when we started regulating where porches were going to be more strongly, so we wanted to be a little more clear on what a porch actually is in terms of really projecting out from the front facade of the structure.
Thank you, Jeremy. Mm-hmm. Any questions, Mr. Sharp? You know, I think it's important to those who may be regular visitors here or watch us on TV. Our zoning ordinance as it now exists is relatively new.
Yes, sir.
And it was pretty much a bleeding edge type of undertaking on the part of us. Jeremy and the rest of the staff is charged with making sure that it is consistent throughout. And as you go through something new, whether it's brought to you by the general public or you happen upon it through your own observation, it's important for us to sharpen those points up and make sure that that zoning ordinance, which we're extremely proud of, by the way, is consistent and conveys the message that we wanted to convey. So we appreciate you, Jeremy, and your folks staying on top of that. And I didn't want those who were just compelled to watch this on TV to think that you're here just to, for a perfunctory type function, if you will. What you're doing is critically important. It keeps us very, very focused on making sure that our zoning ordinance is in compliance and does the things that we hope it, and it, that is intended to do. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Any further comment? Susan?
Okay. The motion is to recommend approval of a text amendment to the Norfolk City zoning ordinance. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. I think you forgot, Ms.
Austin.
Dr. Austin.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Thank you, Susan.
The next item, so the next three items, 2, 3, and 4, I'm going to read them as one. We're going to have one presentation, but then I do, I will make them as separate motions.
Thank you, Susan.
Number 2, a request by Brinshore for a rezoning from CR Regional Commercial to D-SP Downtown St. Paul's for a conditional use permit to allow more than 24 dwelling units. And for a development certificate at 450 Posey Lane, the purpose of the request is to allow the construction of a mixed-use, mixed-income development. As you know, the site is located, you've got St. Paul's, you've got the fire station, you had Block 19 that we have looked at and approved, and then behind that, on the northwest corner of Wood and Church Street, is Block 20. I'm going to let Mel Price with WPA make the presentation on this one.
And in fact, the chair acknowledges for the record, Mel Price.
Good afternoon, members of the Planning Commission. So I'm Mel Price with Work Program Architects representing the City of Norfolk. And my address is 208 East Plume Street, Monticello Arcade, Suite 2.
Thank you, Mel.
Thank you. Okay. Then you want me to move ahead to the, okay. So I have a general presentation for you that is a summary of work that a whole group of design professionals did when we came together this summer. And it provides the context that allows both the Architecture Review Board and Planning Commission and others to really understand the development projects as they come forward, put everything into context. So as you can see at the bottom, there are many, many firms from all over the country that came together with city staff, the planning department, and the city manager's office. And we hosted, I guess, about 65 people in our office. So these are engineers and designers from all different disciplines working together. We wanted to start with the background and just take the project back to 2018. When the mayor and city council members and others worked with the community to establish the design principles. And just wanted to be clear, today we're just talking about the design principles and parameters for the project. On the left, you can see the 7 principles that were developed. The first was to respect the water and to set the foundation in making sure that we have dry and safe and beautiful development. The second principle was to provide educational opportunities. So let's locate a school and places for adult learning and enhance continuing education. The third principle was that we need to restore Church Street as the heart of the community. So every project that you review on Church Street is going to be something that's very, very important to the project and at the heart of the community. Fourth principle was to start to work on east-west connections and bridging between the east and western sides of our city that have been disconnected over time. Then we wanted to look at developing neighborhood scale blocks, safe, pedestrian friendly, neighborly streets, and starting to set up that framework so that daily life can happen and this can happen in a good framework. Additionally, we wanted to provide employment opportunities, especially at the high density areas along Church Street and along the edge of St. Paul's Boulevard. And I can't read all the text, but you get the general idea. So 7 principles over there on the left, and those were reflected in the CNI plan that was submitted to HUD. Moving ahead, last spring, we looked at making some adjustments. We looked at making some adjustments to Church Street to allow for Church Street to really be the heart of the community. And we looked at drawing a line between the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial and the steeple of St. Mary's Church. And if you've ever walked around in just the best cities in the world, you see these iconic landmarks that guide you as you walk along the streets. And so we made some adjustments to allow for that. Also provided development opportunities for those employment centers as we move to the higher density developments to the south. At the same time, the city was working with Stromberg Garrigan Associates on the Brownfields grant and resiliency work around Harbor Park. And we saw that good design work happening, and we thought we needed to kind of bring it all together. So you see that plan on the right. That plan really made connections down to the Elizabeth River and to Chesterfield Heights and over to Norfolk State University. So we brought everyone together and we layered the CNI plan and the Brownfields grant, and we started to look north because we realized it's not just the CNI boundary that's going to have such an enormous effect on the people who live here in the city, but we needed to kind of work our way north and take a look at the big picture. So we broke ourselves up into four areas of study, and I'd like to walk you through each one. So the first foundation setting area of study is really our resilience plan and making sure that we slow and store and drain our water, and in doing so, we create beautiful amenities for residents. The second area of study was the street framework to make sure that we had streets that were safe and pedestrian friendly and really setting up the right size block to make it easy to walk around the block and get to know your neighbors and shop on local streets. The third area of study was the housing plan, making sure we have enough places for people to live and enough variety of housing types so that people could choose where they wanted to live, in a high density, high rise apartment, or townhomes, or single family, and so that there's a really appropriate variety and diversity of choice. And fourth, to look at areas where we could really hone in on mixed income, mixed use, employment opportunities, retail, and have these truly mixed use areas that are just super concentrated. So we'll start with resilience. To kick off this charrette, we took a look at the work that the city and consultants had done in Chesterfield Heights and the Ohio Creek Project, and we brought some lessons learned forward. So we looked at the floodplain, and we had some buildings that were kind of straddling the floodplain. We looked at the cost of removing the soil and filling, and we decided, as a best practice, let's move everything out of the floodplain, save on construction cost, and start to shift things around a little bit. We looked at just shifting the stormwater management to align with the historic creek beds and estuaries. We did some work to find out where the culverts ran and to design a floodable park system around the historic creek beds. And you can see that here. And if you look at the line of the blue greenway as it curves through, it mimics what rivers and tributaries kind of naturally do, which is they cut into the earth this kind of sinuous curve that helps slow everything down, and the water kind of finds a path of its own. So we wanted to design something that mimicked that natural flow. And then it creates little pocket parks that tuck from side to side. Down at the bottom right is a kind of a 3D modeled cross section through that. And just above that is a hand-drawn section showing kind of in hard lines, the culvert at the bottom, and then these layers of floodable park-like areas where native salt-tolerant plants would go, and this becomes, could be a playing field, and then when we have a rainfall event, it starts to fill up. And then this is what it looks like when that starts to reach through the community on the east-west axis. So this is actually Freemason Street. It's the Freemason Street Stormwater Park. And you can see how we're taking resilient strategies and then putting them on display and showing them off and creating an amenity for the neighborhood. So this is a plaza combined with our stormwater park. Area of study number two, our street framework. The team worked really, really hard on this plan, and we looked at this in terms of creating the smallest network of neighborhood streets that was possible. In the neighborhood areas, you can see in the legend, the red, the orange, the blue, and the green are four different scales of streets, with the higher traffic being routed around the perimeter. so that we can provide smaller scale, safer streets throughout the middle of the St. Paul's area. These are street sections on the right of the largest street down to the smallest street. And the difference is that when we have a little bit more traffic and we have areas like Transit Way, where buses are, we have about 60 buses an hour wrapping around the block. In those cases, we want to separate the modes of transportation so that families feel safe with people biking on the streets and traffic is not commingled. Once we move away from those streets and we get to smaller scale, we're tightening up down to 30 feet from curb to curb. So when you drive out in the suburbs today, you see streets that usually are around 42 feet. If you're in Florida and California, up to 48 feet from curb to curb. We're back down to 30 feet, which is really Norfolk's historic street section in Ghent and Freemason. And they're those nice, safe neighborhood streets where you have to kind of work to pass each other in the street when cars are parked on either side. So we're proud that that's really being recreated in the city. On the left is an image of a major avenue like Church Street. So north of Freemason, you can see dedicated bike lanes on both sides of the street, and then landscaping separating the two sides of the street. Since this is a larger street section, we have taken care to provide enough room for wide sidewalks and plenty of room for tree roots to grow so that we have landscaping, tree canopies, and shade on the sidewalks. On the left is a drawing of one of the local streets. Again, parking on both sides, very narrow street, super comfortable for families to walk up and down the street. Stepping up a scale, this is an avenue. So this is designed to accommodate limited through traffic, but we want to still keep these tight enough so that people are not cutting through the neighborhood. Again, safe, family-friendly streets. But this is an environment that retail could really thrive. So parking on the street, easy visibility. So moving on to the third area of study, which really is the most important, which is providing housing for our residents. This shows you some of the first areas where housing will occur within the CNI grant. So you have looked at block 19. After this, you'll be reviewing block 20. And so this area focuses on, just on the right in the plan, around blocks 17, 18, 19, and 20 that really wrap around the bus transfer station. Higher density, taller apartments. As we move to the east towards the Resilience Park, that's where we start to step down and scale to those townhomes and hopefully even a little bit of single family. Those areas, blocks 17 through 20, are true mixed income, mixed use, retail on the ground floor. As we move farther east, residential development really follows those seven principles in providing housing choice for families. And you can see the scale of the buildings. As we move away from Church Street, the buildings in red are always marked with mixed use with retail on the ground floor. And then we move into smaller scale in orange and then yellow. So families may choose, if they want a little more outdoor area, they may choose to locate near the east. This is some old data. As Brinshore, the developer, is bringing architects in from all over the country, each building is being designed, and one building may have a couple more units here, a couple more units there. But this just shows that we're meeting HUD's requirements for the housing and the appropriate mix. Moving into the fourth area of study, providing mixed use employment opportunities. This again happens on St. Paul's and on Church Street, and especially as we move either north or south of the bus transfer station. So the first area to the north circles around the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial. And the strategy here is to develop four strong corners. And from that first area of development to kind of build upon that strength and let the redevelopment start to spread out. So we really hold down those corners. Then to the south, blocks 7 and 8, You can see many different colors there that stand for office use, institutional use in purple, retail in red, mixed use in orange, and residential. So we have everything happening in one area in blocks 7 and 8. And this is what that could look like. So this is the four corner strategy in use around the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial. And you can see the bike lanes in green starting to wrap around, trying to create, to slow down traffic. This is a really busy intersection, but we still want to create a walkable environment where people feel comfortable moving from corner to corner and working their way north. Just zooms in on the plan of that area a little bit closer. And this takes a look at blocks 7 and 8. And here you can really see the office in blue, residential in orange, commercial and retail uses in red, and our institutional uses in purple. So this is what those neighborhood streets could look like. What you see is a narrow street. You see areas of planting with a little bit wilder native vegetation, places that can hold and store water, front porches following the definition, the new definition in the zoning ordinance, with a place to sit and gather, and it has covering over so you can hang out there in the rain. And they're really places for neighbors to sit outside and talk to each other and start to build that community. This is a image of Church Street looking towards the steeple of St. Mary's. And again, from a little bit higher elevation, looking back to St. Mary's, looking at the Resilience Park at Freemason over to the left. And looking at Freemason, as Freemason enters St. Paul's and starts to curve around the bend a little bit. So a really nice walkable street with ground floor retail. And back to our Resilience Park. So we have a role in the St. Paul's process moving forward that I think will be important to both the Architecture Review Board and the Planning Commission. And so we're providing design assistance, which means that as the developer brings architects on board, our job is to kind of welcome them to Norfolk, walk out to the site with them, provide them with background information so they know how important the project is that they're designing and where it's going, and they have the proper context to begin the design project. We're going to be a resource to them. If they have questions and they need help and they need someone to reach out to, we'll be there for them. And then we will prepare memos, and you likely received one for Block 20 from us in the future that will give you a little bit of background so that you know that we've met and how we've evaluated projects to meet the design principles for the St. Paul's area. An additional tool that we're developing and I think showcasing Monday morning is a 3D model of the entire St. Paul's area. So this is the new street grid, street trees, landscaping. We have people, cars, bicycles, all of the buildings that you see as boxes on the plan popped up in 3D. It's a tool for you, for you all. It's a tool for the architects and developers. As they come on board, they can take their design, plop it into the model, spin it around, and figure out if it's relating properly to all of the other parts and pieces of the whole design. So it's open source. Anyone can grab the model. They can put their buildings into it. They can test things out. And we really hope it's going to be a useful tool in rendering and evaluating projects moving forward. So, any questions?
No, thank you. Mm-hmm. Question, comment, commissioners? Yes, ma'am.
I'm overwhelmed because it's the way it has been approached, the way you've brought everyone together, how organic it is and how knowledgeable it is of what happens in cities around the world that have developed over time. And Norfolk is an old city, and it's interesting to see how the thinking is really geared to growing again what the city was, because it comes organically from how people live. And a city should be a place where everybody, no matter what economic level they are, can have dreams about where they're going to go, what they're going to be, and what their life might look like. I don't say that to be poetic. I think it's really rooted in making a city where people function and are happy and contributed to. So I commend all of this because it's wonderful. I've lived in cities that have done this because I've lived abroad, for instance, mm-hmm. and I can say that it creates a rhythm to everyday life that makes a city a wonderful place to live. So I'm really overjoyed to see that Norfolk is engaging in this kind of thoughtfulness and planning.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dawson. Any other comment at this point?
Mel, the most common thing we hear from the citizens when we do these neighborhood plans is that they want a mixed-use neighborhood,
yes.
whether it's Ward's Corner or St. Paul's or downtown. Mm-hmm. Everybody wants mixed use.
Mm-hmm.
Should we be concerned at all that thus far for St. Paul's, all we've seen is multifamily apartments? Because to me, mixed use means mm-hmm. variety.
Mm-hmm.
And three projects that have come to us thus far mm-hmm. have been multifamily apartments. And I'm concerned that that might be the not where you want to start.
Okay.
Because it may not encourage the other variety.
Okay. Well, I think we've set a principle together that mixed use is critically important, especially on Church Street. And I think that the challenge is that we have a commitment to ensure that the folks who live in that area have a place to move back home to at the completion of this grant. And so what you're seeing as the first phase of projects come through is the city trying to deliver on the promise to provide that housing. I won't speak for the developer, but I think it may not have been pointed out previously, but there's over 8,000 square feet of retail on the ground floor. It may not start as retail at this time. We need to build up density and a critical mass before those businesses can survive. But everything's being designed with that to kind of slide into place in the future. So what's a community room right now may change as the demand calls for a corner market or a shop or something that is kind of the highest and best use for the community once the community is filled in there. So I think it's important that we make a space for it. We may not be able to convince a retailer to be in the very first building when there's not yet anything else around it, but we have to ensure that there's a space made for that so that the whole vision can be realized as we move forward.
To speak to your concerns, I've lived in a redevelopment of the city. This mm-hmm. was in Chicago,
mm-hmm.
where this kind of development was done, but already existing mm-hmm. buildings. They were rehabbing a lot of old architecture. But what was interesting that happened, because they did make sure that there was ground retail mm-hmm. in a lot of these buildings, it wound up that the people who were living there, and it was attracting just the kind of people that we're talking about, that from that group of people, they themselves invested and experimented with mixed use in those buildings. So mm-hmm. I don't know enough information about what has happened over mm-hmm. time. That was a while ago, but that type of activity mm-hmm. can come about from this mm-hmm. this kind of situation.
So you've reviewed Block 19, which did not have retail, and that's adjacent to the bus transfer station. Now you're reviewing Block 20, which has over 8,000 square feet of that space. It may not be programmed right at this phase. We've just had a design charrette with architects who've come in from all over the country specifically to program the ground floor retail. So we know generally about how many square feet is planned to be programmed. We've talked about potential mom and pop shops and national retailers, mm-hmm. but it's this first phase where you're seeing 19 and 20, and then you'll see 17 and 18. The retail is coming in the design phase just behind it in terms of the exact programming. So a space is being made for it, and then that layer will come in the next design session. So we've had one one session where we started to think about uses. We've talked about a food hall. We've got incubator spaces, et cetera.
Right. And whether the building has first floor retail or not, is mm-hmm. it going to be multifamily apartment building after multifamily apartment building?
Nope. I think pretty soon you'll start to see other types. So you'll start to see townhouses. You might see some other building types that you haven't seen built around here in 80 to 100 years. So you'll start to see a more diverse mix. It's just that the first projects that are coming through happen to be all in that high density area. So the design team and the developers and the city have met and talked about the residents' desire and city council's desire to see some of those other housing types soon. And so we're going to shift and start to bring some of those forward more quickly.
And does the St. Paul zoning ensure that that's going to happen?
Would you like to answer that one?
So, Mr. Murphy, the St. Paul zoning, as y'all remember, is a floating zone that lists options. And each parcel has to come through, just as this one is coming through, and be individually rezoned at this point. We've talked about taking that master plan that Mel showed us and adopting that into the ordinance and saying if it meets this, then it doesn't have to come through a rezoning process. But we haven't made that decision that that's the direction we're going. So, quite frankly, between y'all and City Council, y'all hold the keys to the kingdom on each and every one of these projects as it comes through right now. Mm-hmm. And if I could just add one little aphorism to the this, please do not let perfect become the enemy of really good here. That things could be more perfect is always a possibility, but that shouldn't stop us from moving forward with things that are pretty good.
I agree, and we could like an individual project in a vacuum, but if that support of that individual project makes it less likely that a different type of project will follow it, then I want to go into that with open eyes.
What encourages me is that the process mm-hmm. by which this is taking place is so inclusive and diverse. Mm-hmm. That makes me hopeful. That the very things that you want to see, that you are mentioning, have the possibility of happening. There always are consequences to what you do that you sort of can't plan for. But the process is in place here with the way that it's been approached, where I think we have a very good chance of coming up with an exemplary cityscape. As a whole, I really do, and a model for how, in concert with what other cities are doing, especially of our size, and what we can achieve for the future.
Commissioners, we have some more folks that want to speak on this, and I'm certainly delighted to hear this dialogue. But I want these folks who signed up to speak to have an opportunity. I have some comments myself. Mel, if you stand by, that's great. Yes. Let the chair acknowledge right now Richard Shortino.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Rich Shortino. I'm one of the principals at Bryn Shore Development, and we are the lead developer for the housing portion of the CNI transformation plan for St. Paul's. This is the first time that I've had...
Give us a mailing address, would you, Mr. Shortino?
Sure. My Bryn Shore Development is located in Northbrook, Illinois, and Northbrook is just outside of Chicago, Illinois. We are predominantly multifamily housing developers that concentrate on mixed-use, mixed-income development. So what we're engaging in here is similar to what we've done in a number of places around the country, and I was just counting that we're involved with 9 other similar master planned communities like this in cities like Grand Rapids, Michigan, Omaha, Kansas City, Houston, and a few in Chicago. I think that you've heard some of the things today that will define how we approach this project. I think that the planning that has been done up until now is what we consider the framework around or through which we will engage in this development process. But I want you to hear from us about how we intend to approach this. So you've heard a little bit about the planning, and you've seen some of the images around the architecture. I will say that The first phase, which is what you've seen, was done because as part of the CNI application, as part of this process to achieve this $30 million grant, which we received from HUD, that we had to show readiness, and readiness meant that we had to really engage in this first phase quickly. And so I will say that going forward, that the process around how we engage design and the community in that process will be much more hands-on, and I'll explain some of the things that we have in mind. But our approach is generally to be as inclusive and collaborative as we possibly can. So that means everyone from the residents for who will be living here to the stakeholders who represent, the elected officials who represent this community, and to people that represent the city. You've obviously been engaged, but we've also been engaged with the residents and with the St. Paul's Advisory Committee. We intend to bring together a group of residents to act as an advisor to us on the design process, and we also plan to bring together a group of young people from the St. Paul's community to observe. Our hope is that in observing the process that many of you have seen and are involved with, that they may get excited about the idea of participating in one of these professions. Overall, the intent is that we are designing a neighborhood that is both diverse, inclusive, and an exciting place to live. The reason why we have so many different architects, and all of them there's a reason for them, for each of them being involved. We have a woman-owned architecture firm. We have an African-American-owned architecture firm. We have a couple large firms. We have a firm from Chicago, a firm from Washington, D.C. It was this idea that when we're done, we do not want this to look like a singular project. We want this to look like a neighborhood in Norfolk that is organic, that it is a place that when we are finished, that will resemble any other neighborhood in Norfolk, and that people will not drive through it and say, this is the so-and-so project. We want to avoid that. So we want a diversity of design ideas. We want to bring together a bunch of design professionals in the same room and get the creativity that comes from that, and we've seen that so far. And so our hope is that through that process, that we will begin to see some exciting designs, different types of buildings, and really begin to think about how this all interplays into the development. I also want to say that this is not just about housing. So what you are seeing is the housing aspect of all this, but we are much more involved in the overall environment of this development. So that means program aspects of this. In Chicago, we have in the middle of one of our developments a 2-acre urban farm that is run by a not-for-profit that provides job training and also provides amenities for the residents who live there, not the least of which is that it's a beautiful amenity. We have another art center, both in Kansas City and in Chicago and now in Houston, where we have engaged nonprofits that are involved in the arts, that have programmed a beautiful art centers that have become community hubs for our neighborhoods. We plan to incorporate those here. We plan to incorporate recreational amenities for people. One of the advantages here is that while half of that site is in a floodplain, which means that we have to create some density on the places where we are not in the floodplain, it leaves a lot of land that is available to us to think creatively about what we could use some of that land for. A lot of it is being used for water management, but a lot of it hasn't really been thought through in terms of what is possible, thinking that potentially that could be an urban farm, it could be a soccer field, it could be a number of different things. So all of that is to create a rich, vibrant place that is both programmed, that has amenities. There will be retail, there will be, you will begin to see mixed use for these spaces where we are not able to find good retailers. And we are building in Chicago, we are building 18,000 square feet of incubator retail space, 1,000 square foot spaces for community retailers where the rent is $1,000 a month. In Chicago, that's very reasonable. But it was a result of having created a retail node two blocks away with a Walmart, and all of the community retailers said, "Hey, where do we get to? You know, here's a Walmart that is using prime real estate. What about us?" And so we built 18,000 square feet of retail space so that community retailers can go in and take space and activate the street. We intend to do something like that. In Kansas City, we have arts groups that are using spaces. All of that is to say that this is not just about the built environment. So that's obviously very important, but it is also about the quality of life for the residents that are going to move back in there. I think I've said enough. I think I really just want you to have heard from me as the owner of Bryn Shore Development that we take seriously this idea of planning and architecture and design, and we intend to fully engage everyone in this process.
Thank you, Mr. Shortino, and we appreciate you and the Bryn Shore organization being a part of this very, very vital project for our city, and look forward to what evolves from that. And you might stand by also in case there are additional questions. The chair would also like to acknowledge Maury Kirk, who's here to answer questions. Okay, thank you, Maury. Before Mel, I'm going to have to get back to you because you got to give us a presentation on item number one. But just some very very broad terms about this whole St. Paul Quadrant and Bryn Shore and the projects that are before us. I haven't been involved in this from the birth of the St. Paul idea some 10, 12 years ago now. I don't know that we have undertaken in this city anything more vital and more critical to our city than this. I think from a very, very broad perspective, if this turns out being a gentrification, then we will have failed. The idea is to make this community, when it ultimately evolves, to be a mixed use, mixed residential, mixed ethnic, mixed socioeconomic community, that folks who are living there now are able to come back to sustain and acquire and sustain housing, and at all levels of the social economic strata will be wanting to come back and live in and participate in as well. So my greatest fear, and I think Mr. Murphy mentioned it in broad terms, that what we're seeing now doesn't seem to portend that that's what we're going to get long term. And I too would want us to be very, very careful about that. I think you laid out a very, very careful plan about what we would like to see as we expand into St. Paul's, and I would want us to hear very, very rigidly to that, to make sure that in addition to the multifamily, multi-story units that we see before us today, that as we evolve into the project, that we do get single-family, mixed-use, detached and attached single-family homes, various other amenities that pertain a wholesome, inclusive neighborhood. And if I'm and I've not heard anything today that goes against what I've been hearing. It's just that what I've seen proposed so far doesn't seem to bear that out. And I realize we're at very early stages, but we will want to be careful that we don't in any shape or form not allow this to become a gentrification where we displace people of lower socioeconomic means with those of higher socioeconomic means. That in this case would pretend that we've done the exact opposite of what we have talked about doing. And with that, commissioners, we have any further question at this point or comment?
I would just add that not only do we not want it to be a gentrification project, we don't want it to be a concentration of poverty either. And building only mixed family apartments, we run that risk. And so I've just great concern about what we're doing first in the area. Mm-hmm.
And I trust Mel and you and your team, Susan, would truly take that under advisement. With that, I need to get back to you on item number two, Mel.
And I'm going to have to flip through a bunch of slides to get you back where I was. Give me just a second. I shouldn't have gone backwards. Okay. Do I need to reintroduce myself?
Be nice, Mel. That way I won't have to ask you to do it again.
Mel Price with WPA, 208 East Plume Street, Monticello Arcade, Suite 2, downtown Norfolk.
Thank you, Mel.
Thank you. So I'll be presenting the design for Block 20 on behalf of the developer and Cox Cleaver Architects. So I just want to make it clear this is their work and their hard work that's gone into this, and then we've worked together as a team as the project has come in through ARB and really finessed the project together. I'm going to skip through, there we go, existing conditions. So this is the first floor plan. So the project is bounded by Church Street, Wood Street, Transit Boulevard, and Posey Lane. And so we'll start to work our way around the site. What's important to print to point out, and I'm going to walk over here for a second. Mm-hmm. This is the existing Fenn Church. And then this is the street realignment as Church Street moves over. So on this particular, get back to the microphone. On this particular site, the architects had to think about the site as it sits now and the site as it adapts to the movement of the road in the future. So you'll see that in the renderings. On the ground floor, you can see everything in gray to the bottom left, wrapping down all the way down Church Street into the back is that 8,000 plus square feet of retail and community uses, public areas. ARB had asked for some changes to move the more private functions like the fitness center to the back where residents can easily go out into the green space and go indoors and outdoors, and that they move more public uses to the street front so that that space can adapt and grow and change over time. Moving up to the second floor, so you'll see that on the ground floor, cars come in on Posey Lane and they start to move up into structured parking. The apartments wrap above and really conceal the parking as you move around the space so that you're not looking at parked vehicles. And then you can see a mixture of one bedroom, two bedroom, and three bedroom apartments. So this elevation shows the Church Street facade is viewed from the sidewalk across the street. To the left, you have a piece of public art on the corner, and that's where Fenn Church swings out to become the new Church Street. And we developed this triangular space plaza that affords extra outdoor seating room, places to gather. You'll see cars parked along the street, a bike lane running by in green, and lots of space for street trees. The architects have broken down the massing of the building to be reflective of the character of the spaces inside. And so it was important to the Architecture Review Board that the building really reflect what's happening inside the building in those various activity zones. And there's five of them. First are the areas where we have apartments. So those are the residential zones. Situated near the front entrance, behind all of the glass, and up at the large balconies are the residential activity zones. So those are the more public spaces of the building that bring the residents together. Along the ground floor, we have retail spaces, community spaces. Those are marked with awnings that kind of send a signal that kind of welcomes the public in. And the architects took their cues from the awnings from looking back at historic photos of Church Street, which if you looked back at those photos in a while, there are two things that really stood out to the Architectural Review Board. It's the canopies that kind of march down Church Street. It's also the really beautiful details in the brickwork. And then maybe a third would be the blade sign. So it's really marking it as a commercial street. The massing of the building is broken down into those five zones, and where you see the roof kind of turn down and the glass start to separate the different zones of the building, that's the strategy for taking what is a very long block and start to break these up into smaller pieces. So each of those zones have a different color scheme, and you'll see them change as we move around the building. Important spaces like corners and pedestrian entrances are marked with bright colors at the ends. So again, it's kind of serving as that beacon directing your attention as you are drawn down the street. And then as we start to move around the building, this is Church Street and Transit Boulevard as we start to round the corner. And you'll see the canopy wrap around the side. And as we keep moving down the street, there's places for bikes and The building starts to give public space back to people that may be biking in and hopping on a bus, and the two buildings really start to interact with each other. You'll see the bike lanes in green, large crosswalks, really wide sidewalks. And architecturally, again, we see the roof wrap the corner and that break at the corner. This is Transit Street. And so as we round the corner from Church Street, again, the building mass kind of turns down. There's our glass hyphen that separates the building masses. And you can see the awnings start to continue along onto the corner as we wrap to Posey Lane. Important to note, the architects made some changes to the materials and the colors of the building. As we wrap around the corner on the north side of the building, this side is often in shadow, and so it's important to use lighter colors so that it still looks very welcoming and friendly to people. So here's the corner of Transit Street and Posey Lane. Again, a really bright beacon on the corner. You can see we have real balconies that have some real depth. We have nice materials turning into those balconies. The architect has designed, I think, three different railing patterns. So we have some perforated panels, we have some straight up and down pickets. And so the different building details change as you move to these five zones around the building. You can see the bike racks there, and then a space for public art and mural where people will likely be waiting under that canopy, shielded from the sun and the rain as they wait for buses at the bus transfer station. Kind of in between these two, you start to see the building mass carve out along Posey Lane. The building steps back. This is where cars enter the garage. It steps back to kind of provide a safe cone of vision in and out. And there's it's kind of sculpted out to create a green space and park space for the residents. So we turn the corner, you can see the mass at the end of the building, and then you can see the building step back into that green space. And then the corner of Church Street and Wood Street at the main entrance, the architects have worked to increase the level of streetscape plantings and pedestrian amenities and enhance the landscaping at the front to clearly mark the two entrances. And hopefully this will play.
Do I need to press anything?
Control and...
Just click? Nope. Okay. Control. Sorry, not a power pointer. Let's see. I have to escape. Okay. Maybe just click on it. Thank you.
Which one?
Thank you. There we go. Okay. So we're moving from Church Street around to Transit Street. You see the canopies extend. You see the bus on the street. Those lighter building materials, the balconies that have enough depth to put a table and chairs out there. A nice large canopy at the corner, shading the bikes, providing cover. As we move around towards Posey Lane, we see the green space kind of sculpted out of the corner and the garage entrance that's tucked away and hidden with the landscaping in front. Rounding the corner to Posey. This is a long facade and a long block, and it's important that the block at this point bends, and the bend is marked again with one of those glass hyphens to try and break apart the mass of the building and break down the scale. You can see the architect is placing bright colors in those stairwells so they'll kind of light up and glow at night, as well as a glass entry. So it's kind of welcoming the public in.
Mel, are these buildings elevated?
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Ramon. This, you know, it's the massing is broken up, but it is one long massing. Mm-hmm. So, and it's been a while. I think we've seen the elevations and everything mm-hmm. on this. But what is happening in relationship to the, at least breaking the massing up mm-hmm. on the facade to inside? Mm-hmm. Because you talk about relating it to the kinds of spaces.
I think I started that discussion and then I kind of left you there. So the massing breaks up the five zones of the building. So the first one is commercial and retail, the active zone. It's really focused at the corner of Church Street and Wood Street. Church Street and Transit. The second is the apartment amenity active zone that's really handled with more glass. And that's at Church and Wood. The residential street frontage really wraps the whole building, but the massing steps down, the openings get smaller, you start to see the balconies appear. Wherever possible, they work to provide walkways connecting porches to the street. So any place that they could have a door leading out to the street, they worked with the grading of the sidewalk and really provided steps down to really connect to street. There's the parking garage, the passive zone, that we don't want to see what's behind it, and so it's screened, and that has a different character. And then there's the transit access active zone. So that's a secondary apartment entrance, but that side of the building kind of reaches out and provides amenities for folks who are taking the bus and using the bus transfer station.
Can you move through the entire zone?
Yes, you can. So you can circle through the whole building. But it was important to, the ARB said there were three things that were critically important to them. They said that the Church Street was treated with the highest importance, that you could clearly identify the different types and zones of the building, and they said this was critically important for future projects as well, that the design of the building relates to the design of the street. And we just talked about the street sections and the different scales of the street. They think it's very important that the building relate to that particular scale of the scaled street. And so as the building changes as you move around it, it's really addressing very different size streets.
Are any of the units within the building, in terms of moving through the building, mm-hmm. are they integrated with one another? I mean, can a person mm-hmm. move through the entire structure? It doesn't have to be mm-hmm. a straight mm-hmm. line or hall, or so to speak, or a series of hallways, mm-hmm. but there is a way for people to interact throughout the whole structure, that people don't wind up being segregated in mm-hmm. different blocks of the structure.
So it is a full donut, and mm-hmm. at points where the building hinges, the interior corridor widens to create kind of a gathering space. So I'm not sure if that will be furnished with loose furniture, but there you can connect throughout the whole building, and then there's places that are a little bit more generous that could be an interior gathering space within the residential hallways. So the whole thing does connect.
Any further questions, commissioners? Mel, this is a LIHTC project, is it not?
It is.
And the concept is the third, subsidized.
It is.
Market, subsidized, workplace, market rate.
It is.
How do we assure that we get there?
How do we assure that we get there?
How do we assure that we get to that third breakdown?
I might have to direct that question to the developer.
Okay. Well, you know, I'd like some feedback on that. Mm-hmm. Because if the market rate isn't renting, mm-hmm. what happens? Hypothetical, hyperbole, I know, but...
No, let's let Rich mm-hmm. address that. And
fine. Come on, Rich.
Thank you so much.
They'll be deed restricted so there'll be a regulatory agreement with the Virginia Housing and Development Authority that mandates the unit mix that will stay intact for 30 years.
So the temptation to lower market rate rent to get a tenant is going to be eliminated because it's going to be mandated by a covenant or deed. Is that correct?
Well, I wouldn't know. No, that's not the rents.
Okay.
The tenants' incomes that are within the building. So that mix of a third, a third, a third will stay static. the rents will not stay static. So presumably as cost of living goes up, the rents will go up. It sounds like your concern is that the rents would actually go down. Frankly, we in mixed income buildings, the market rate rents are typically through an appraisal. The investor likes to see the rents, the market rate rents, be at approximately a 10% discount to the overall market rate rents in the community. So they will be slightly discounted at the beginning, but thereafter, generally, we do a market study every year, and we try and adjust to the market.
Thank you. Any further comment or question at this point? Susan, we're on item number two. Is that correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So to accommodate this project, we have three things that you're considering. We've got to do a rezoning, so get it into, as George mentioned, this is a floating district. So we've got to rezone the property, get it into that downtown SP St. Paul's district. Again, there's more than 24 units, so you need a conditional use permit. And finally, any development in the St. Paul's district needs a development certificate. So I'm going to read three different motions. The first, so this is by Brinshore. The motion is to recommend approval of the rezoning. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
She's not here.
I'm sorry. And Dr. Newman is absent. And Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Okay. The second, also Brinshore, the motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
And then the last, again, this is Brinshore, the motion is to recommend approval of the development certificate. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Critically important, this project to our city, and I certainly look forward to being a full participant in that. I'm enormously proud of my city to have taken on something this massive. I don't know if we've traveled all over the city, all over the country, rather, looking at similar projects. Nothing approaches the magnitude of this. So this is a huge project for us. I want desperately, personally, for this to be successful, and I look forward to it being so with the commitments that have been made, not only today, but in the past, and I'm sure in the future. I vote an emphatic aye, and we'll make this recommendation to council, and I wish us all very good luck. Thank you. Susan, item number five. I'm sorry. Item number one on the regular agenda, excuse me.
And so I'm doing the same thing here. We're going to have, I'm going to read this as one. Mm-hmm. We'll have one presentation, and then we'll do three different motions. Okay, so it's the Monument Companies for an amendment to the future land use map within the city's general plan, Plan Norfolk, from institutional to multifamily, for a change of zoning from IN institutional to conditional MFAC, multifamily apartment complex, and for a conditional use permit to allow more than 24 units at 435 Virginia Avenue. The purpose of this request is to allow the construction of a multifamily apartment community with 60 apartment units and 8 townhomes. Okay, so this site is located at the northwest intersection of 38th Street and Llewellyn, where 38th Street meets and intersects with Caroline Avenue. It is surrounded by the Colonial Place neighborhood, generally single-family homes. There is a little bit of multifamily in there. And the proposal is to allow for the adaptive reuse of the Jeb Stewart School into multifamily, and then to allow an additional 8 townhomes on the kind of vacant site and parking lot to the east of that. Okay, so again, to accommodate this request, we have three things to do. Number one, we have to amend the general plan. Right now it was a school, so it was the general plan denoted it as institutional. We have to change that to multifamily. We have to rezone it, again, get it out of that institutional rezoning into multifamily apartment complex to allow for both the adaptive reuse as well as the townhomes. And finally, anytime we want to do more than 24 units, it does require a conditional use permit. So this is the site plan here. Obviously, the larger structure on the left-hand part of the slide is the school. I believe they are doing historic tax credits for that, so that will remain as is and have to meet all the criteria as any historic tax credit does. And then again, additional townhouses will be built on the area that you're seeing on the right of the slide. The entry will be two, one from the north, one from the south. And then parking, they do comply with our parking requirements, which are, I think it's one for the apartments and then 1.75 for the townhomes. Again, this is a, we think, a really good adaptive reuse. We get to keep the Jeb Stuart School. It is actually, it's a contributing structure in, again, not a local historic district, but a state and national historic district. Great adaptive reuse. So staff is recommending that it be approved subject to the following conditions. The site shall be generally designed in accordance with the subdivision plan prepared by Kinley Horn, dated August 24th, 2019, titled Conceptual Landscape Plan Attached Tier 2 and marked as Exhibit A, so we tie them to the site plan. Mm-hmm. And importantly, any change, modification, or addition to the school building shall be reviewed by the ARB. So we get that school as if it's in a local historic district. Any changes have to go through the ARB. So with those conditions, we are recommending approval of these applications. Okay. Any questions?
Questions? Thank you, Susan.
Anyone? No one signed up?
Mr. David Dahlman? Just for questions? Thank you, sir. Chris Johnson? Chair will acknowledge that there is no opposition to this application. Commissioners, any question at this point? Ms. Pollard.
Okay. The motion is to recommend approval of the amendment to the future land use map within the city's general plan, Plan Norfolk 2030. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Thank you for your continued investment in the city. I vote aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
I want to echo what Mr. Murphy just said. You folks have done remarkable work here in our city. It made me extremely proud to save some historic buildings in many instances, put them to significant reuse. And a city like ours is just inundated with these types of buildings. So we appreciate your initiative and thank you for making an investment of your time and your resources in our city. I vote aye.
Okay. Item number two, the motion is to recommend approval of the change of zoning subject to the proffered conditions. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchin?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
And then the last one for monument is the motion to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation, City Council. Good luck.
Okay. The next item is Enjoy Church for a change of zoning from IN Institutional to Conditional SF6 Single Family 6 at 111 East Bayview Boulevard. The purpose of the request is to create a single family zoning lot.
Mr. Morrison.
Good afternoon, everybody. So this request is from the Enjoy Church for a change of zoning at 112 East Bayview Boulevard. The property is located on the north side of East Bayview, east of Granby Street in the north side neighborhood. There's a single family home on the property already, and the applicant's proposing to create a new single family zoning lot where it currently is located. The site's currently zoned IN for institutional. In 2006, that property was rezoned from a single family zoning to institutional so that house could be used by the Monument of Joy Church that's situated next door. The new proposal would reverse that rezoning from 2006 and return it to its the existing single family home to a single family zoning designation. The structure was constructed in 1966 and the proposed lot meets the minimum requirements for the SF6 zoning district. The property is located in an accident potential zone, and residential uses are generally not considered to be compatible in this zone, but City Council and City Planning Commission can approve these proposed use of this property at the lowest density and intensity that is considered reasonable. And because this structure has existed in place for more than 50 years, staff believes that returning the zoning to a low-density single-family lot would be considered reasonable. And it was zoned to single-family for 40 years prior to 2006. So staff is recommending approval of this rezoning subject to the proffers in the staff report. I can stand by for questions.
I was just making a comment to Mr. Hales. You mentioned it was in the accident potential zone, and I'm wondering why. And this dawned on me, being an old and awful, but Chambersville is right almost immediately adjacent to this place. Forgotten about that.
Yes.
Thank you, Hank. Any questions of Mr. Morrison? Thank you, Hank.
All right, thank you.
Chair acknowledges that there is no opposition to this application. We're here to speak in favor of Zoe L.
Available for question.
Thank you, sir. Susan, commissioners, any comment? Susan.
Okay. The motion is to recommend approval of the change of zoning subject to the proffered conditions. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We make that recommendation to council. Good luck.
Okay. The next item is by Drufen, Inc. for a conditional use permit to allow the sale of alcoholic beverages off-premises at 2550 Ellesmere Avenue, Suite E. The purpose of the request is to allow an office warehouse to offer online sales of wine and beer for off-premises consumption.
Hi.
Hi again. So this is a request for a conditional use permit from Drufen Incorporated to use an office and warehouse as its location for an online wine and beer retailing and delivery service at 2550 Ellesmere Avenue. This site is located in an office park on the northeast corner of Ellesmere Avenue and Henneman Drive in the Elmhurst neighborhood. The property is zoned BCO for Business and Commerce Park Office, and they are requesting the conditional use permit to allow sale of alcoholic beverages for off-premises consumption. Because this is an office zoning district, there's no requirement for a physical storefront when conducting retail sales that would otherwise be required in a zoning district like CC, or Community Commercial. The space is located roughly 350 feet from a residential district, but the warehousing space is smaller than 20,000 square feet, so no additional CUP is needed for the warehousing use. And that warehouse space is 7,118 square feet. The applicant hosted a public meeting on October 17th and also attended the Greenwood Elmhurst Norview Heights Civic League on November 18th, and staff did receive a letter of support from that Civic League on the same day. Given that this use is consistent with approved plans, staff does recommend approval of this conditional use permit subject to the conditions in the staff report.
Thanks, Hank. Commissioners, any questions of Mr. Morrison? Susan?
All right, thank you.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
I will make that recommendation to council. Good luck. Okay.
The next item is 416 Aphrodite, Inc. for the following conditional use permits at 200 East Plume Street. A, a commercial recreation center. B, extended hours of operation. And C, a restaurant with live entertainment. The purpose of these requests is to allow a restaurant where seats will not be with live entertainment and amusement or gaming devices until 2 o'clock a.m. Okay. This site is located on the north side of East Plume Street, just east of Granby. It's right behind the Dominion Enterprise building. It is in the downtown business center, one of our downtown districts. So it is zoned downtown. And they are proposing to operate a facility where there's a restaurant on the first floor, and then they've got a commercial recreation center, which is games where you insert a token or a slug, so video games, on the second floor. And then the entertainment will also be on the second floor as well. As I mentioned, it is zoned downtown business center. To accommodate the request that they are looking to operate, as I mentioned, it will be a restaurant. They do want to open till 2, so that is extended hours. They do want to have the live entertainment. And again, they would like to have that second floor commercial recreation center. As far as the operation, they are looking to operate from 8 to midnight, Sunday through Wednesday, and then on the weekend, which is Thursday through Saturday, from 8 o'clock a.m. till 2 o'clock a.m. Mentioned they had entertainment. They have live bands, karaoke, sip and paint, board games, spoken word, and a fashion show, so no DJ. And then their occupancy, they have in total 132 seats, no outdoor seats, and then for a total capacity of 251. This is downtown. We do have a zoning district that encourages such uses. The only change, we, as you know, on these conditional use permits for entertainment, we have a full list of conditions that talks about the hours and keeping the sidewalk clear and free of debris. One of the issues that was raised by the Planning Commission is this has been a site that there has been issues with before, and as we do with other sites where there has been issues, we are going to establish a sunset clause on this one, meaning it gives the applicant about a year and a half to operate. At that point, they have to do they do have to come in and reapply, and that way it's kind of a probation period. If there's no problems, they reapply and they go through the process. If there are problems, it gives us an opportunity to have a discussion with them to indicate what those problems are. So with the host of regular conditions and that additional condition, staff is recommending that this application be approved.
Thank you, Susan. Any questions of Ms. Pollock at this point, Susan?
When they come through the second time, do they have to pay the application fee?
It's a reduced fee.
Okay. I don't want to be unfriendly to small business.
Reduced fee.
Here in favor of this application is the applicant, Mr. David Williams. Mr. Williams, please come to the podium just for a minute, sir. I don't mean to signal you out. I think Ms. Pollock has highlighted a lot of our concerns. I just want to reiterate, this site doesn't have the best reputation.
Yes.
And I'm sure you are aware of that.
I'm very aware.
And we have, of course, put the sunset clause in place to more or less have an opportunity to police what goes forward. I just ask you to be extremely mindful of that. I've had the unpleasant occurrence of viewing videos of things that have transpired at this location in the past. Trust me, they were not pleasant. And I trust, sir, that you would do all within your purview to assure that we don't have a repeat of untoward activity, mm-hmm. that we don't have circumstances that lend visitors to our city to label this particular area of our city as unpleasant, and that you have a meaningful and rewarding experience as a business person in terms of making this a worthwhile endeavor on your part. So I ask that you commit yourself to us as well as yourself to do all in your power to make this a very, very pleasant opportunity.
That is our plan.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate that.
Thank you.
Commissioners, any question or comment? Thank you. Susan?
Okay. The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permits subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinances. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to council. Good luck.
Okay. The next item, Neon House, for the following conditional use permits at 819 Granby Street. A, for a banquet hall. B, sale of alcoholic beverages on premises. C, live entertainment. The purpose of these requests is to allow for operation of a banquet hall with live entertainment, including a disc jockey and alcoholic beverages for on-premise consumption.
Mr. Morrison.
Hello. So yes, this comes from the Neon House for a conditional use permit to operate banquet hall with live entertainment and sale of alcoholic beverages for on-premises consumption. It is located at 819 Granby Street, south of West Virginia Beach Boulevard in the Neon District. The property is zoned DAD for Downtown Arts and Design District, which allows for the requested uses with a conditional use permit. It's located in the Coastal Resilience Overlay, and because they're proposing to spend more than 50% of the appraised value on the property on improvements, they will be required to dry flood-proof the building. There is no parking requirement downtown, but there is a parking lot directly to the north of the building that has 20 spaces available for use. The proposed hours of operation are 9 a.m. until 2 a.m., 7 days a week. Then they're proposing to have a DJ, live band, comedians, fashion shows, church services, speakers, karaoke, and magicians as options for live entertainment. The occupancy is 460 seats indoors with 0 seats outdoors, and a total capacity of 598 people. The proposed uses are compatible with the district and many of the other surrounding businesses in the area. So staff is recommending approval of these requests subject to the conditions in your staff report.
Thank you, Hank. Any questions of Mr. Morrison at this point? Chair acknowledges that there is no opposition to this application. Susan?
Yeah, the applicant.
Oh. Okay, I'm sorry. Marcy Telfer. I'm sorry, I overlooked you. Do you have anything you'd like to add?
I'm available for questions.
Thank you, ma'am. And my apologies again. Susan.
Okay. The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permits, subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinances. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Hutchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to Council. Marcy, good luck.
Okay. The City of Norfolk to vacate a portion of the right-of-way of Mayflower Road between Virginia Avenue and Carolina/West 38th Street. The purpose of this right-of-way vacation is to allow for the construction of a new sanitary pump station that will provide improved service to the Colonial Place neighborhood.
Thank you, Mr. Patel. I was looking to see Mr. Morrison again, so the change of pace is good.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Afternoon, everyone. The applicant for this application is the City of Norfolk, Department of Utilities. The applicant is requesting to vacate an unimproved portion of Mayflower Road. The purpose of the right-of-way vacation is to construct a new pump station which will serve the Colonial Place neighborhood. The right-of-way to be vacated is chiefly surrounded by single-family housing and is located on the east side of the J.B. Stewart Elementary School and by the Llewellyn Avenue. Appropriate utility easement and adjustment has been made with the Dominion Power, and we are still working on a couple of them. Staff has determined that the existing lane is not necessary for access in the future and is appropriate for the vacation. So with that, we recommend approval. And I stand by for any other questions.
Thank you, Karen. Any questions at this point, commissioners? There is no opposition to this application. Susan?
The motion is to recommend approval to vacate a portion of the right-of-way on Mayflower Road. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchin?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. New business, Susan.
I believe you all received a copy of the...
Yes, we did. Calendar for next year.
The 2020 Planning Commission calendar.
Commissioners, at this point, do we have any concerns with regard to next year's schedule?
I'm excited for it. Looking for a comment.
There is no opposition to this application, Susan.
The motion would be then to approve the City Planning Commission, what do we call it, just 2020. Schedule, 2020 schedule. Mr. Hales?
Aye.
And Ms. Austin? Ms. Austin?
No. Yes.
Mr. Hutchins?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. Thank you. At this point, Mr. Melita, do you have anything on your agenda or desk for our attention?
No, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Mr. Homewood?
Mr. Chair, on behalf of the staff, we'd like to wish you and your family and those of all the members of the commission happy and merry holiday season and a joyous and safe new year.
You stole my line, George. I, too, want to offer staff and members of the commission and all your family and friends a very Merry Christmas and happy and safe New Year. And hearing none, Lenny, a special vote of good health to you going forward. We're looking forward to seeing you right after Martin Luther King's birthday. All right. With that, ladies and gentlemen, we stand adjourned. Thank you.